Nind Animakaj. We wish to express our gratitude and recognize our presence today on the traditional territories of the Algonquin Nation. In recognition of these Aboriginal voices from these lands of our cities, we invite you to listen to one now through a short video teaching rock. It is described as the heartbeat of Mother Earth is felt in the urban landscape in a tribute to the connection between the Anishinaabe and the land.
Let's drop that lake of the woods, the bottom. Geronimo, there's rhythm in the water. From where my life come, there's power in the air. We live by the drum.
Our country has a wound that we must heal. 2 weeks ago on the Maclean's cover was writer, broadcaster, and proud Winnipegger, Rosanna Jeerchild. The cover, quote, reads, "They call me a stupid squaw, or tell me to go back to the res." The Maclean's piece provided an uncomfortable mirror of who we are. It has ignited a discussion about how we, as Canadians, must change. These events and the introspection that followed coincided with the finalization of our report. These underscored how critical is the issue of Aboriginal people's voice within Canadian cities. Ultimately, reconciliation is about learning about each other, understanding our shared history and envisioning our common future, knowing that the project of Canada must be for all Canadians. A report is about that reconciliation. It recommends engaging Aboriginal peoples in city governance and celebrating urban Aboriginal peoples' contributions to Canada's urban mosaic. But our task is certainly incomplete. We have only joined an ongoing journey. We have no pretense that we have come to its end. But we have learned the importance of listening. And our foremost recommendation is that our fellow Canadians should have the opportunity for the same. The Urban Aboriginal Peoples study found urban Aboriginal peoples perceive a stigma attached to their being Aboriginal. Specifically, 71% of Aboriginal respondents perceived that their Aboriginal identity was viewed negatively by non-Aboriginal Canadians. On the flip side, non-Aboriginal citizens are frequently confused about where Aboriginal peoples fit into the Canadian mosaic. Simply put, the parallel experiences of Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal peoples in Canada's major cities often represent two solitudes. But concurrently, there is a sort of Aboriginal renaissance underway in our cities, with a growing cohort of educated, entrepreneurial, and passionate Aboriginal peoples who do not view urbanity and Aboriginality at odds.
Urban Aboriginal peoples, we are growing presence in our urban centers. We're growing faster than the population rate, at over 20%, and more than half of us live in cities. We are at a moment of opportunity as a nation. Reconciliation is critical to the future prosperity of our cities. And cities can play a critical role in this process. Because cities is where we build our lives and forge relationships. They are the most visible and accessible form of government. The city of Vancouver provides a great example. In 2013, the city declared a year of reconciliation. In partnership with local First Nations and urban Aboriginal organizations, the city undertook a number of programs and events to celebrate and to engage in a dialogue on reconciliation. Most notably, the city engaged in a walk for reconciliation in which 70,000 people came out in the pouring rain to engage and participate in the process.
Over the course of our project, we have conducted a number of interviews with municipal public servants, city-level policymakers, thought leaders, representatives from First Nations and Aboriginal organizations, governmental officials, and the business community. From these conversations, we would say that three main gaps persist. First, over and over, we heard how important it is for municipal and city leaders to recognize Aboriginal voices and their cultural contributions to the life of cities. A second important theme from our discussions revolves around the lack of mechanisms, that is, formal structures and processes that can facilitate more opportunities for urban Aboriginal peoples to have input both in planning for the delivery of services that directly affect them. This can be in terms of land use planning, housing and homelessness, youth programming, for instance. Secondly, we also examined the notion of the engagement of Aboriginal perspectives and dialogue more generally in civic processes and municipal issues. Here, I've surveyed for you some existing models, but it's important to emphasize that while there is promise, more needs to be done. These models are nascent, they're often ad hoc, and reliant on the goodwill of a couple of community leaders. The experience of cities and the lessons learned and what can be transferred from one city to another is not currently very well documented either. Finally, third gap, another common theme from our conversations concerns the lack of awareness in the general population and of the country's past and present reality in relation to Aboriginal peoples. This is something that is powerfully illustrated by a quote you'll find on the screen. We're grateful for the work that has gone before us and to the Canadians who've shared their time and their wisdom with us. En puisant à même nos conversations des derniers mois, nous sommes ici aujourd'hui pour partager avec vous nos recommandations que nous avons regroupées en quatre grandes catégories. Vous pouvez également consulter notre rapport aux pages 12 et 13 pour un aperçu écrit des recommandations. From our conversations over the course of the past few months, we've come here to propose four broad categories of recommendations.
Recommendation one, cities need to establish better channels, structures, and policies to engage with urban Aboriginal partners. So this recommendation has four subcomponents. We feel there is a role for an organization to create a common repository for best practices and lessons learned so that cities may learn from one another's experience. Thirdly, when there is an effective model of representation, it needs to be fully developed and requires sustained resource commitment. This recommendation stems from our discussions with frontline Aboriginal service organizations who indicated that they desire to participate in civic level policy formulation, but lacked the necessary resources for sustained and meaningful relationships with the municipality. The last element of our recommendation is that when possible, we need to commit to 3 to 5 year planning horizons for representative councils or committees. Such medium range planning approaches will allow for participation in the formulation of measurable goals for evaluation mechanisms and for lessons learned.
Second recommendation is to increase two-way education and awareness to help bridge the gap between Aboriginal peoples and non-Aboriginal Canadians in urban centres. In consultation with Aboriginal organizations, we have heard that cities need to provide opportunities for frontline service workers, including counselors, teachers, bureaucrats, and so on, to learn about cultural experiences and insight of the lived experiences of Aboriginal peoples they serve.
Service delivery organizations are organizations that all of us deal with on a day-to-day basis to access fundamental services like healthcare, education, housing. And the landmark Urban Aboriginal People Study that was, again, referred to earlier in the presentation did a survey to look at what the perceptions were of urban Aboriginals, as well as Aboriginal peoples, as they engage with service delivery organizations that are run by non-Aboriginal Canadians. And while some urban Aboriginal peoples reported positive interactions with some of the services, many urban Aboriginals, including low-income urban Aboriginals, reported majoritively negative interactions with services like social housing, social assistance, and child welfare systems. The root causes that the study gets into were highlighted as negative experiences due to racism or discrimination, being treated unfairly or disrespectfully, service provider staff being judgmental, rude, lacking empathy, not understanding their needs or culture, or simply not believing the people. And what we're really proposing is that service delivery organizations, as well as decision makers that design and develop services, undertake review of current services, identify the impact that service delivery has on urban Aboriginals, engage them in a conversation, and in partnership with them, take steps to design or redesign services.
Our final recommendation is about embedding territorial and cultural recognition as part of the ongoing reconciliation process. Recognizing traditional territories is much more than a symbolic act. The importance of the recognition of Native ceremony and culture in conjunction with these other recommendations creates a sense of belonging. There are several ways this can be achieved. One might be recognition of traditional territories in city council sessions and including cultural practices in official city events. This can also be embedding cultural practices or artwork by partnering with other levels of government to create places and spaces, mentioned by an earlier team, to celebrate urban Aboriginal heritage and cultures. By proactively starting the dialogue and sitting down with local partners, local First Nations and urban Aboriginal organizations, cities can take a leadership role in this process and openly invite a discussion to commence. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite my colleagues to share a little bit in closing their personal reflections and journeys in terms of preparing this report.
Start. It was actually hard to find the words to express something that should be relatively simple. And I think how I would put it is that at the beginning of the project, I was seized of the importance of the issue. Progressively, I discovered how little I know and I knew about my country's history and about the reality of the people who've been living on this land for much longer than my own ancestors have. This project is about hope, it's about dialogue, it's about creating the opportunities for people like me and some of my colleagues who've never had an opportunity to engage, to start becoming a bit more acquainted and aware and creating the space for dialogue to occur between Aboriginal peoples and non-Aboriginal peoples in Canada.
At the outset of this project, I understood this issue in the abstract. The legalities of constitutional obligations, the statistics around socioeconomic outcomes and demographic conditions. This project connected me with the humanity of public policy.
My family immigrated to Canada and we landed in cold Winnipeg. And we were warmly welcomed and we strived in our new city. Over the years, I realized that not everyone in Winnipeg is given the same opportunities and welcome. In particular, Aboriginal people are not welcomed the same way. This deeply troubled me, this inequality. This exercise that we have gone through has been an opportunity to explore an issue that's very important to me and to the future of Winnipeg. This opportunity, this exploration, has actually been very uplifting. Through our journey, we've met with Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal leaders who spoke of hope and the power of reconciliation. It made me very hopeful for the future of Winnipeg, and that there will come a time where Winnipeg is going to be so much more powerful because of its relationship with Aboriginal people. That'll come.
As a nutritional scientist who has spent much time working on maternal and infant health, I knew before this journey the importance of bridging the gap between non-Aboriginal Canadians and Aboriginal peoples in Canada. But through this journey, I have seen the importance of creating dialogue on this issue. I learned English at the age of 10, and at the time, I was taught that the word people was plural. But through this journey, I have learned that referring to Aboriginal peoples carries a huge weight. So small changes like that can have a huge impact.
So being a first-generation Canadian, or first-generation immigrant, who is a Canadian now, I had very limited exposure to our Aboriginal history and culture before the start of this project. So this project was really a great journey for me personally, just to be able to experience the rich culture and history that our country has as a legacy of the Aboriginal peoples and a culture and history that needs to be celebrated. One other reflection that I have to share is, in my professional life, I've actually worked on optimizing service delivery for certain organizations. And we've taken a very objective look at processes, and that's how we generally look at things. This journey has made me realize there is a third dimension that needs to be explored while designing or redesigning those services, and that's the cultural aspect of people that those organizations serve.
And going through this experience was also an act of, to some degree, discovery and rediscovery of experiences of my relations across the country, and getting to see the kind of hard work they do every day reaffirms the importance of this issue and my commitment to it. And watching my colleagues go through this process and going through it with them has given me such a sense of hope for what we can achieve, and a real clear sense that the issue is timely. And I'm excited for what can happen, and I've learned a lot about the issues in terms of how difficult they are, but I see that there is a path forward. And so I'm very grateful to my colleagues for their interest and support and dedication to working on this. And I look forward to what happens next. Thank you.
Project. My name is Mark Miracle. I'm the chairperson with the Ottawa Aboriginal Coalition. And I think simply what you've undertaken in terms of shining a light on an element of our society that has been undervalued and misunderstood. And it's nice to see young leaders take this on. Clearly, the older generations have not seized the opportunity. And it really is an opportunity for all of us to reset the agenda and be more inclusive and build the type of relationships that are going to make us grow together. Thank you very much.